Father, we just come to you. We humbly bow before you. We thank you for your word, for the time we have to open up that word. So, Father, just show us your truths today. Let us get that inside our hearts and retain that, hang on to it. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. There's a singer probably most of you have heard of, name of Elton John. Elton John has some issues, but he's had some great music through the years. And he spoke about his personal issues at Oxford Union, and he said that his late father never told him that he loved him. Never held him, never came to see him perform. He said that he thought he didn't deserve to be loved or cared for. Well, he's not alone. There's millions of children today who are growing up with that same feeling that maybe they don't deserve love, and if they are loved, well, it's a conditional love. They feel affirmed by their parents if they make good grades, or if they excel in sports, or have an outgoing personality, have some wonderful talent, or rise above the other kids. We get confirmation from our parents, but it's not just moms and dads who project a conditional love. It's the entire world. It's a world we live in. If you're good at this, wow, look what you get. If. We make idols out of athletes. Actors pull in the big bucks. Singers make millions. And all are treated like there's something special. And many of them act like it. Social media. That can make a person feel great or make them feel like committing suicide. Social media bullying, it's a major thing. And it's one of the main reasons for attempted suicide in our kids today. More people base their worth on the approval of others on social media than ever before. How many likes did I get? How many people saw this and liked it? You know, Satan wants us to believe that there are conditions to God's love. Satan wants us to feel that we have to gain the approval of God. But that isn't true. Conditional love, well, that's a satanic lie. That's something Satan likes to use. It reaches its worst when we believe God loves us conditionally. If we sin, if we mess up, if we fail, he's going to no longer love us like he once did. Satan wants you to believe that. Don't get hoodwinked. Don't get lied to. Don't get bamboozled. This lie comes from the very pits of hell. Let me tell you something. And I could say this and end my sermon right here if we could really get a grasp on this. God loves you. But so oftentimes when we hear God loves us, we have that conditional thing pop into our head. God loves you. He always has. He always will. He loves you with an undying, unconditional love that doesn't depend on your appearance, your performance, your success, or your attempted perfection. God cannot love you any more than he does right now. God cannot love you any less than he does right now. whether it's love, support, or surrender, if something is unconditional, it's absolute and not subject to any special terms or conditions. It'll happen no matter whatever else happens. It's unconditional. He loves us unconditionally. Before we were born, He loved us unconditionally, and He still does. Ephesians 1:4a says, even before He made the world, God loved us and chose us in Christ. God made the world, but before He made that world, He loved you, and He chose you in Christ. That's why Christ suffered and died. He looked down through the ages and saw you. He saw you. And He loved you unconditionally. Wow. Unconditionally. Unconditionally. Absolute. Not subject to any special terms or conditions. He loved us and still does. Psalm 139, 15 and 16 says, you watched me as I was being formed in utter seclusion, and I was woven together in the dark of the womb. You saw me before I was born. Every day of my life was recorded in your book. Every moment was laid out before a single day had passed. Think about a heavenly father who loved you before you were ever conceived. As earthly parents, we love our children before they're born. Right? You're pregnant, you're carrying your kid, you love your kid. But did you love them before they were conceived? You see, we can't even fathom that. But God loved us before we were ever conceived. Let me tell you something. God will not abort you. God will not abort you before or after you're born. I've asked youth this question. I said, what do you think would happen in today's world if Mary was in today's world and became pregnant with Jesus as she did? What do you think would happen when she started telling people it's of God? And she started telling people what happened, how it took place. How would people respond? Well, for one, they probably wouldn't believe her. They didn't then either. But what would the chances be of putting enough pressure on Mary if she would abort Jesus? Think about that. God will never abort you before nor after you're born. He'll never just give up on you and say, that's enough. Why? Because He loves us. Unconditionally. Jeremiah 1:5a says, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Think about it. Before you were conceived, God knew you. God loves you even if you don't love Him. See, that's the thing about today. We forget to think about that. All these folks are out there lost and going to hell. They don't love God, but God still loves them. We are able to love. Why? Because God loved us first. 1 John 4:19 says, we love because He loved us first. Because of this love, God loves us so strong that He gave us redemption. John 3:16, for God so loved the world. Not this ball of dirt. Yeah. Not this planet floating along in the universe, but the people on it. For God so loved humans that He gave His only Son. His one and only Son. His only child. For God so loved the people upon this ball of dirt that He gave His only Son, that whoever believes in Him, whoever says, Jesus, come into my heart, will not perish, will not go to hell, but will have eternal life. I love the way the Passion Translation says this. For this is how much God loved the world, that He gave His one and only unique Son as a gift. So now, everyone who believes in Him will never perish, but experience everlasting. everlasting life. Sometimes the Passion Translation just makes it pop out there. So, is God's love unconditional? Well, yes it is. But if God's love is unconditional and He loves us this much, then why do believers suffer? Hebrews 12:6 says, "For the Lord disciplines those He loves and chastens every son whom He receives." Why do believers suffer? What does this even mean? We love our kids. We teach our kids. Sometimes we have to discipline our kids. Think about that for a minute. We love our kids and we have to discipline those kids. Well, God's the same way with us. Because He loves us so much, He disciplines us. He chastens us. When He does this, it's to teach us. Not to harm us, but to teach us. He does this out of love, just like we do with our kids. But why do Christians have to suffer? Sometimes God allows this to teach us something. This is true. But there's no pat answer for this. There's no scripture that says, this is why. I believe there's a lot of reasons why believers suffer today. I'm not going in depth with these. I'm going to share just five of my thoughts on this. There's a lot more, I believe, than just these five. Sometimes we suffer because of our own stupidity. Hear me now. That's what I call stupid human tricks. Sometimes because of our own stupidity, things happen. And oftentimes we like to blame God to take responsibility for it. I believe another reason is sometimes we take a stand. When the righteous take a stand, things happen. Satan will come against you and throw everything at you he can. We stand for what is righteous, we stand for what is truth, the enemy will come against us in different ways. Another reason is sometimes we suffer because of sin in our life. Paul said in 1 Corinthians 11:31, "But if we judged ourselves truly, we would not be judged." We can judge ourselves when we're wrong. If we don't, God will chasten us. He will get on to us. Right? He'll do this why? So we will not be condemned by the world. God wants His kids doing the best we can do. He wants us out there living the life of Christ that we should be living with Jesus in our hearts, the Holy Spirit in our life, and God directing our footsteps. We want our own kids to be out there doing the very best they can do. Right? We don't want to hear that our kids just mess up over and over because they want to. That's no fun. Another reason is sometimes we suffer because of past sins. Galatians 6:7 says, "Do not be deceived. God is not mocked, for whatever one sows, that he will also reap." Sometimes we forget that when we plant those things, when we sow those things, they're going to come to about. How many times do we sow the seed and then pray for no harvest? Think about it. Man, I hope that doesn't come into fruition. But oftentimes, I tell you, God's not going to be mocked. What we sow, we're going to reap. Another reason, last one I have on my list here, is sometimes it's a reason only God knows. Sometimes it's going to build up His kingdom, but we can't see past the troubles of right now. When I was diagnosed with prostate cancer, I was determined I wasn't going to have prostate cancer. I was determined God was going to take that away from me, so I didn't have to mess around with it. But guess what? I still had it. Still had my prostate removed. But then something weird began to take place. Other men started calling me. Hey, I heard you had prostate cancer, yeah? And can you talk to me about it? Sure. I don't know how many men called me up. I didn't even know who they were. Somebody told them, and somebody said, and they'd call me up because they had prostate cancer, and they want to talk about it. And it would give me the opportunity to talk about God. God used that to help build up his kingdom. It was something I couldn't even see. I had no foreknowledge of that when I had to go through all of it. But if we take what happens to us, people are going to ask us about it. So, you've been taking a high dive off any other ladders here lately? No, once is enough. These are only five reasons. I believe there's a lot more of them. John 16:33 says, I have said these things to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation, but take heart. I have overcome the world. I'm going to read this to you from the Passion Translation. It won't be on the screen. It says, and everything I've taught you is so that the peace which is in me will be in you and will give you the great confidence as you rest in me. For in this unbelieving world, you will experience trouble and sorrows, but you must be courageous, for I have conquered the world. Amen. Psalm 34:9 says, many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers him out of them all. Even when he disciplines us, he still loves us. You know, when you read about in the book of John the story of the vine dresser, Jesus is going through a vineyard on his last night before his crucifixion. They go through a vineyard and he starts saying, you know, my Father is the vine, I am the branches. Right? And he goes through the whole story. But if you study out about a vine dresser, if there's leaves down in the dirt and mud, they pick them up, they clean them off, they tie them up, so they produce. But sometimes the vine dresser has to prune things back. It's not because he's mad at the vine, but because he wants the roots to do the best they can do and produce the best fruit. I did tree trimming years ago. I had people say, oh, I just don't know, you can cut my little tree. I said, tell you what, let me do it this time. Let me trim your tree. It's going to look better, but it's going to grow. Well, it hadn't grown in a long time. That's because the roots are overloaded. So I trimmed their tree up. Next, oh, come back, trim my tree again. You won't believe it doubled in size. Yep. See, that's the way it is with a vine. Sometimes they got to clip things back so the roots aren't overloaded. But when God does that, he's not mad at us, right? He's just removing some of the stuff we shouldn't have. He's just showing us how to be, well, better believer, producing better fruit, 100-fold. The Lord will love you forever with an undying love that matches his everlasting love. Now think about that. The Lord will love you forever with an undying love that matches his everlasting love. Not only does it match his everlasting love, it matches his everlasting life. Remember, unconditional is it's absolute and not subject to any special terms or conditions. Romans 8:35a, who shall separate us from the love of God? The Passion Translation says, who could ever separate us from the endless love of God's anointed one? Absolutely no one. Nobody can separate us from God's love. Nobody. God tells us about 500 times in His Word that He loves us. 500 times. Do you tell those folks you love that you love them? I do that all the time. With my wife, with my kids, with my grandkids. I talk to them on the phone. I see them in person. I love you. Love you too, Papa. I send them a text. Tell them I love them. All the time. All the time. We need to remember to tell folks we love them. Well, God does that too. About 500 times in His Word, He says, hey, I love you. We need to remember that. He loves us. But here's the clincher. If God loves us unconditionally, and He does, then He expects us to love others in the same manner. Oh, preacher, you just went to meddling. He expects you to love that person that's just naughty to you, just nasty to you. He expects you to love your kids, your grandkids, your parents, your cousins, your aunts, your uncles, the folks down the street, even that person, the store that's rude to you. He expects us to love them anyway. Our church family. He expects us to love each other. That unconditional love, that undying love. When we love someone, it doesn't mean that we condone their way of living. Remember that. We can love somebody and not condone their way of living or condone their attitude. It means that we love them because we love Christ. And we want them to come to Christ also. I've often said, if you want to get even with somebody, lead them to Christ. What does that mean? Lead them to Christ, you don't have to worry about why you don't like them because everything's taken care of. Lead them to Jesus. Remember, Satan is all about hatred. Satan can hate you for no reason. That's just him. Don't be hoodwinked. Don't be fooled. Leave the hatred to Satan. God loves us. Love as Christ loves us. You know, the Greek word agape, or agapeo, depends on how you want to say it, means love. It's an unconditional love. But it has been, well, folks think it's a Christian invention. But it really does come from the Greek. People think it's a new word, but it's from the Greek. We study out the Greek. Agape is a Greek word. Agape draws its meaning directly from the revelation of God in Christ. It is not a form of natural affection, however intense, but a supernatural fruit of the Spirit, agape love. It's a matter of will rather than a matter of feelings. Did a wedding here last night, and as I'm doing the wedding, I reminded him, I said, hey, listen to me. We don't fall in love. People fall in love all the time. They fall out of love. I said, love is a choice. I said, every day I choose to love my wife. Every day I choose to be married to my wife. Love is a choice. We must choose to love Jesus as He loves us. We have to choose to love others. It's a choice. Our invitation is born. I want to relate to you a story that Dick Hills wrote in his book, Love is a Costly Thing. And he tells a story. He says she was lying on the ground. In her arms, she held a tiny baby girl. As I put a cooked sweet potato In her outstretched hand, I wondered if she'd live until morning. Her strength was almost gone, but her tired eyes acknowledged my gift. The sweet potato could help so little, but it was all I had. Taking a bite, she chewed it carefully. Then placing her mouth over the baby's mouth, she forced the soft, warm food into the tiny throat. Although the mother was starving, she used the entire potato to keep her baby alive. Exhausted from her effort, she dropped her head on the ground and closed her eyes. In a few minutes, the baby was asleep. I later learned that during the night, the mother's heart stopped, but her little baby girl lived. Love is a costly thing. God, in his love for us and for the lost world, spared not his own son to tell the world of his love. Love is costly, but it must tell the world at any cost. Such love is costly. It costs parents and sons and daughters. It costs missionaries life itself. In his love for Christ, the missionary often must give up all to make the Savior known. If you will let your love for Christ cost you something, the great advance will be made together. Remember, love is a costly thing. Do you love enough? There's a question for us. Do we love enough? Do we love enough to tell the lost and dying world about his unconditional love? Do we love enough? Let's pray. Father, show us that unconditional love. Show us that love that you have for us. Show us that love. Let's get a grasp of that unconditional love. Father, when we don't feel loved, show us what love really is. Father, let us choose to love. Father, we thank you that we can love because you loved us first. We thank you that you have shown us how to love. I thank you for this. Father, is anybody here who needs to do business with you this morning? May this be that time. I just thank you for this. In Jesus' name we pray. Let's all stand.